many women though. And I'd only wash my hands, but I don't have that opportunity.
Yeah. Just put it under the dripping cap.
Yeah.
Just feel a bit fizzy.
40 minutes later.
Fucking exciting. The reaction we're going to get.
Mate, did you read that next big thing? You know, take your fucking R&B and your hip-hop, rock and fucking roll, man. Big day out.
They're the only other fucking band you need to know. British India and us.
That's yeah.
It. Wolf Party. Remember. Now fuck off.
2005. The year we met one of the greatest and most tragic bands of our time. Wolf Party were our friends, our enemies and our peers. I'm Declan from British India, and this is the story of our two bands over 6 years.
I remember, like, when I was just kind of out of school and started playing and started listening to rock, and British India and Wolf Party were kind of like this new sort of post-grunge, just stuff going on. It was really fun and exciting. And
had this sound that brought together elements of grunge, elements of 70s prog.
We saw the Fred Dursts, you know, coming out, and it must have been the way we were raised, so thanks, Mum, but we were able to see through that. And so we didn't want to become that, so, you know, I mean, it's been happening since the 60s. Men have been falling in bands to get the attention of girls, so we tried that.
It's been a really good friendship to have. They've given us some good hookups over the years. We've helped them out at times.
No, I'm also an alcoholic.
Oh, I'm thinking what they do. And then I... whole different... creative songwriting values, probably maybe a bit more diverse. I see things as an abstraction. I don't like presenting art on face value. Oh, this is what it is. When I get interviewed, what inspired you to write that song? I don't think that's any of your fucking business, frankly.
Just like the first time we ever plugged in a guitar and we could barely play, but like looking across the room and seeing Matt playing and seeing hearing Will play is just like a real euphoria.
That first time that we ever played together as four people is something I probably won't forget.
We practiced all the time. You know, every day was all we did. From midday till about, you know, till midnight.
It's really inspiring to meet a young band with the same ideas of making it big.
I was doing a lot of stuff with like triggers and, you know, tracks when I was playing live, but it just didn't have that same feel. So I decided to get another person in. So obviously I knew Dan.
He had some really good ideas about what other sounds we should bring and how I should sing, and we co-wrote songs.
Nick was a songwriting genius who was ultimately unable to meet the other requirements of being a successful musician.
I kind of just want to play my music accurately. I'm very involved in the sound. As long as it sounds good, that's all I care about, because I figure everything else will take care of itself. Dan's more about performance, and he wants to make things that appeal to the lowest common denominator, which I'm not interested in. I don't want those people into my music. I don't want them praising me. I don't value their opinion. If a fan of our music is one of those people, I'll have no problem telling them to fuck off.
Dan was his right-hand man, a great guy, but unsure about his place in his own band.
You as like a sausage machine, like you as the meat process, and me as the machine that sort of, you know, forms the sausages. So like you were just spewing ideas, and I'm the one who sort of clips them off and makes them into a palatable package.
Yeah, it's getting better, but you know, you've either got the ability to create something new and interesting, or you don't.
So where's Nick?
He doesn't normally do his setup. He's gotta like meditate and get in his space or some bullshit.
What are you doing?
I'm just having a moment. I do this every gig. It's a little ritual thing. get my head out of it. I just fucking hate standing around there before the shows. I need my own time to think and process and contemplate the art rather than flap around fucking setting shit up. Let's, you know, let other people do that. I've got absolutely no time for that shit. You know, that's part of the reason I don't want to sign to a label, because I don't want to be answerable to anyone. I don't want to have my art restricted.
He believes quite firmly that he has to suffer for his art, that it can't be fun, commercially viable and creative.
In 2007, both British India and Wolf Party hit the studio to work on releasing albums. Theirs was a self-titled record with a single called Growing Up Online. Ours was called Guillotine, with the lead single Tie My Hands.
We did this album and it sat on a shelf for a year because no one wanted to release it. And so it actually started to get a bit dour, and we started to smoke heaps and heaps of weed and sit in our back room and just kind of listen to each other's pain.
Somehow we came up with Tie My Hands, Russian Roulette, Run the Red Light and a few other good songs. Released them, they were hits on Triple J, and here we are.
Hello, this is Will from British India. You are listening to the Noni Show on Hall Street Radio.
Great letter. You scored on your radar.
It really started to sink in that it was, you know, an actual really good, great body of work.
We could play four nights a week and have a crowd there. We became the darlings of the in press and beat of the music press and of that kind of what was then. It seems so uncool now, but that was, you know, the hipster culture.
And then I remember we got to Perth. We said, "Oh, cool, we're going to Perth. It'd be fun just for a holiday." And then we found out that, you know, the gigs had actually sold tickets, which just caught us by surprise so much.
It's been pretty cool, like, to see British India, like, they're super famous and travelling the world. And I don't know, like, Wolf Party's kind of, I think they're still playing.
They were getting put on all manner of festival bills nationally, and I thought it was just a fait accompli that we would almost immediately follow suit. And for whatever reason, just didn't transpire.
Nick and I came to grief over the fact that he insisted that the album open with our 11-minute kind of experimental track, and I'm like, can we put it at the end of the album? I didn't want it off the album, I just wanted the end of the album. And he's like, "Oh no, I want it to be our flagship."
It's a statement.
Yeah, but fucking Triple J aren't going to touch it. No one's going to touch it. And
Triple J.
And
how you can get fucked.
Yeah, no, I'm good. I was just wondering, Nick and I were wondering if you wanted to come over tonight and have a jam. It's the first you've heard of it. Oh, I left heaps of messages. Yeah, you are busy. Yeah, no worries. Alright.
What's it now?
These people need to wake up to themselves. Like, there's real art and then there's the parody of real art. British India is successful because they pander to the masses. We don't. We play whatever comes out, they play whatever comes out, filtered through whatever they think is going to be popular. So, you know, it's hardly any wonder, is it?
Hi, I'm here with Dan from Wolf Party. Thanks for joining us, Dan.
Thanks for having us.
Now, I hear with the latest album you spent a lot of time actually writing, collaborating with Declan from British India.
I wouldn't call it a collaboration.
Do you think that the recent success that British India has had has really kind of had a flow-on effect to you guys at all?
To be honest, I think we've been a bigger influence on them.
Is it true that you grew up with them and spent a lot of time with them? What are they like as guys?
Are you going to ask us a question about us? Like, I thought this interview was about Wolf Party.
In 2010, we were promoting our new album, Avalanche, and were given a cameo in Neighbours.
What about a song from these guys?
I tried telling Donna, she hates everything I suggest.
All right, then that's it. Okay, no more talking about the wedding, the Bucks night.
A few days later, Wolf Party released this video. They claimed it was a tribute, but we knew they were dissing us.
Everybody needs good neighbours. That's when good neighbours.
Good
hard to get on Neighbours, mate. Not hard.
That'll show those sellouts.
From here, our bands went in different directions. As we continued to tour and release records, Wolf Party seemed to struggle to keep it together.
It gets very intense when you're in a two-piece. It's a lot easier to rehearse and organise, but the band politics, when there's just two people, gets very, very personal very quickly.
I'm trying to sort out tours, so this little fucking prima donna can push his bullshit. You can play the greatest music in the world, but if no one comes to listen to it, no one's going to appreciate it, you know? And that's what he doesn't get.
Hey, we're Wolf Party. Thanks for having us in the yard. This is our first song. It's called Never Ending Romance Disaster.
Dan, can you turn your fucking mic down? I want to hear your god-awful voice out there. Just turn it down.
What?
Just turn it down on the
mic.
If someone turns Dan, turn down to mic Dan, he's going to be too loud.
It'll be softer than yours, and I'm the lead singer.
With the harmony is going to sound absolutely disgusting. You can barely sing as it is. Turn the fucking thing down.
It's fucked, man. You're such a fucking asshole. Like, you're not even talented. You're just a self-involved fucking cocksucker.
In 2011, we decided to invite them to tour with us to try and help them reach the next level.
Nick thinks that they're doing it to rub our noses in how successful they are and how unsuccessful we are, but I think
they enjoy name dropping us. It legitimises the music they're making, I think.
British Indies Hotel, it's quite nice. It's called the Cambridge.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's not so too dissimilar to our hotel room.
You know, we've been telling the other bands that we're staying in a hotel, but we're really staying at my mum's house. But that's all right. Whatever.
I worry about Dan. He's been in the band for so long and his friend Nick. And it shows up that Nick's the star, but Dan's the one that just keeps trying and trying. And I just worry about him because he really likes Nick, but he feels that Nick's overshadowing him. And he's started to eat a lot more than he should and he's put on weight and that doesn't help his image.
We've been lying about our ages in interviews all the time. We do it all the time. Because Tame Impala is so young, I just can't compete with that.
Do you see, like, Children Collide as a contemporary?
Everywhere they would go, people would, like, we would have toured the year before. Like, Guillotine came out just, like, a year before. What was their first record called?
Self-titled.
And everyone was saying, oh, because he's got Heath has the curly hair, and Johnny and me both rip off the same Kurt Cobain moves. Everyone's like, oh, you guys are just like British India. But if their record had come out first, then we would have been the copycats, you know?
Mm. You guys want a beer?
I'm driving. Because,
yeah, I have. It's like
it's not a party. Gig's not a party.
Okay.
We're playing the Electric Picnic in Ireland, which is really good. It's with Arcade Fire and Chemical Brothers and Pulp. We haven't had a space to write in for months, so we're really behind in songwriting. So it's a concern, actually, because we want to put out a record. We're going to have to put out a record next year. The last thing we would have wanted is to be writing for a deadline, and that's just the situation we find ourselves in now. And it's really repressive.
British India were selling out every night, but our sets were a fucking disaster.
Hey. We're
from Melbourne. Yeah! No one's coming early to see us support British India, so I'm pretty pissed. I put a lot of work into the marketing. Nick, on the other hand, doesn't really give a shit who's there as long as it sounds good to him, you know?
They know what the crowd want, man! This is what the crowd want! Not what we do, man!
Get a bit over it all, to be totally honest. Like, damn.
party promoting Getting It Is. The British Indie guys are really shitting me because they think they're all that, and I could be all that, but I choose not to be all that.
How are the wolf party guys?
Yeah.
Alright. They're having a fucking huge fight before.
I think we're heading down the right path to get to a point where we never have to compromise our brand.
By brand, you mean it's a commodity that can be bought and sold then? Is that what you mean? You know, getting off on the table? Yeah, yeah. That's how you think of the band, is it?
We're not successful enough. We're not.
Why might that be, Dan? Why are we not successful enough? Because one of us is a real estate agent, and one of us is creative and writing.
You're not going anywhere. Don't you see? It's just kind of.
No. Where exactly are you going?
All these.
Where are you going?
No, I'm trying to make the band go somewhere. You're such a selfish, self-involved wanker.
Don't care. Honestly, don't care, man.
So, what's the best British India song?
Oh, mate, they're all good. They're all good, mate.
I'll wear that. They're all good.
Yeah. Oh, you can't make the. Aren't they going to Hornsby?
Hornsby, yeah, yeah.
Are
yeah.
you on before then?
Yeah, we're playing before them.
Mate, we might come then.
You might,
mate.
So, you may not enjoy our stuff if you enjoy their stuff, but.
There's no way we could ever play a regional area with such an arrogant fuckhead like Nick Clark in the band, because his ideas are totally aloof and he wouldn't even emotionally entertain allowing people of a culturally less diverse background into his life.
Look, Dan, I'm from British India. I'll sign anything you want me to sign. Look at that. Oh, just some merchandise. Do you want top 10 single? Do you want a major label deal? I'll sign that too. You hear what they're playing now? Have a look at this. It's pretty good. Oh, yeah.
They don't have to work full-time jobs to support their music.
You can't write any fucking songs. You can barely play the instrument that you were
singing. Well, look, just what you were saying about him like 2 weeks ago, and then to a best friend.
I wasn't saying.
I'm not laughing at it, but it's fuck. How are you guys gonna get band going if you can't
sort this out?
What I'm saying is, you guys need to find a way to get along.
No. Oh, why is it your problem? Why is it your problem?
Because it's how it's not.
Hang on, I'm pretty sure the reason that this dissonance between Dan and I started in the first place is because of the friction you guys have caused within our wider friendship group.
We haven't done fuck all.
You are friends with a bunch of freaks, and you always drag us down to this stuff.
Bunch of freaks.
Freaks.
Creatively, they're freakishly talented. They're part of the machine. They're part of the masses. They can't make up their own minds what is good music. They have to be told what they like, what's popular on radio. Fuck off.
It's like British India. It's so seamless, the way they get along, but Nick and I are constantly bitching at each other.
With every day that we're in a band together, we get closer. For us, I think we learned really early on that if we make this, like, difficult on each other and, like, you know, just fight or whatever, and it's all going to end very quickly.
I don't know if I can keep doing this. Like, when you look in the mirror and go, well, I'm not really young, I'm not really interesting, well, you know, I'm not really successful, I'm definitely not successful.
Last I heard, Dan was working on a solo career.
And I've really been finally given the freedom to embrace the music I hear all the time in my head, you know? Like, Nick would never have had anything to do with that because he was so caught up in his own bullshit little world.
And Nick was finding different ways to express his creative genius.
You know, creativity,
is all one umbrella. You open your mind up to the possibilities, you focus in on the end product. Okay, what are you telling me? What are you telling me? What are you telling me? Lead my hand, guide my hand, guide my hand, guide my hand.
So what are you going to do with this?
Well, I'll sell it. I'll sell all of them. Open your mind up, open your mind up.
Maybe people won't get it now, maybe people won't get it in 5 years, but in the long run, 20, 30 years down the track,
yeah.
someone's going to pick up a Wolf Party CD and it's going to blow their fucking mind.